this is an unprecedented time. And the infection control measures that we learned back when we went to school, one gown, one mask for one patient a day or per time, this is a different time.
How did you find that? Did you find a good supply?
I found that we had what we needed.
Good.
We had to change
Thank
the
you.
Way we did things. But.
Yeah. This controversial moment that took place in the Oval Office on National Nurses Day highlights just how challenging it's been for our nation's healthcare providers. The nurses were explaining that they've instituted new policies that allows them to sanitize and reuse their gear.
If I can sanitize it and it still fits and performs the same form, fit, and function, why not reuse it?
The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, or CDC, released recommendations for extended use and limited reuse of the N95 respirator. Plus, the Food and Drug Administration, or FDA, is issuing new approvals for companies developing innovative ways to sanitize PPE. PPE, or personal protective equipment, worn by healthcare providers protects them from exposure while treating patients or while working in a laboratory environment.
PPE is everything from the gloves that you put on to the gown that goes over your scrubs. It's all the materials that you need to protect yourself and also protect others.
One specific type of PPE that has been in high demand is the N95 respirator. N95 filtering facepiece respirators block out at least 95% of very small test particles. The CDC does not recommend the general public use the N95 respirator. Instead, it recommends the general public use a cloth face covering to help slow the spread of the virus.
The difference between a mask and a respirator is how it seals around you and how it protects the flow of particles from your respiration. So a mask is, in a general sense, going to protect particles from going out rather than coming in. But a regular mask isn't going to have the seal around the face or the positive pressure airflow to protect individuals who are wearing them from being exposed to the droplets.
So respirators, when you put them on, are designed to seal to your face. So now it is touching my face all the way around. And when I put it on, these headbands help keep it tight to my face. Now, it doesn't need to be digging way into my face, but it needs to touch the edge of my face. And that's the really important thing for any respirator, whether it's brand new or whether it's been decontaminated 5 times, is to make sure you still have that seal.
In the U.S., PPE is regulated by a complex network of federal agencies.
The National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health, which is NIOSH, sets the requirements for how N95s have to perform. The Occupational Safety and Health Administration, OSHA, tells us how to select and use the respirators. So they say where they can be used and, you know, how much training people have to have. For certain types of respirators, like you would use in surgery, the Food and Drug Administration has some requirements if you're going to use the respirators as a medical device. And then the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention offers guidelines for use during outbreaks and other emergencies.
Different hospitals also have different approaches and requirements for PPE, which during the pandemic has unfortunately been somewhat dictated by the availability of the gear.
At Johns Hopkins, our PPE plan is either a PAPR or an N95 with a visor face shield. So you're protecting the entire respiratory system and you're protecting the eyes. And then in addition, when you go into the patient room, you're going to have a gown on, a fluid impermeable gown on, and 2 pairs of gloves.
But if hospitals are really in a very sort of crisis situation, then one of the things that they can consider is decontamination of these disposable devices.
PPE is traditionally designed for single use.
A lot of our PPE is not simply a flat surface like those visors are. You know, masks have contours, they have seams, they have ridges, and all of those things make them a little harder to decontaminate.
In a very clean environment like the hospital, the respirator filter material is going to continue to be very good. It will last for a very long time in a clean environment. But the concern is that these are designed so that the straps maybe won't, they'll stretch out after a while. Or perhaps the nose clip that you have to bend, this metal piece, maybe that won't bend as well.
In response to the COVID-19 pandemic, the regulatory agencies have been exploring ways to sanitize and reuse PPE.
So the first strategy is, if you have enough respirators to give every healthcare worker 5, then you should put it in a bag, like a paper lunch bag, and wait 5 days. And after 5 days, the virus will be deactivated and it can't infect anyone anymore. And the reason they recommend that first is because that's not doing any damage to the head straps or the nose clip. However, if people don't even have enough respirators to give everyone 5 and to be waiting, then the CDC has recommended several methods of commercial decontamination. And the FDA has approved the certain companies that make these machines to be able to put respirators in them.
The FDA has issued emergency use authorizations, or EUAs, for organizations to be able to sterilize and reuse PPE.
The types of decontamination that have been authorized by the FDA, the companies, include vaporized hydrogen peroxide and moist heat right now.
As of May 20th, only 12 entries of EUAs have been documented on the FDA's website.
We've tested some of our most popular respirators in the systems, and we are able to say, using that system for 5 cycles, for example, does not damage the filter media or the headbands or the nose foam.
We are learning that we can safely decon a N95 multiple times and still know that it fits and that the filter is working. I'd be much more comfortable going into that patient room with that PPE rather than a mask that is not meant for someone who's on droplet precautions.
Companies are trying to develop other ways to sanitize PPE. Although on February 27th, the FDA issued a reminder that machines using ozone gas or UV light have not yet been approved for decontamination.
We're a company that sanitizes specifically mattresses, soft surfaces, and textiles. We had to pivot, and we had to pivot fast. And I said, let's grab a few masks and see if we can, you know, run them through our machine and test them and see what they look like afterwards. And so worked through the weekend, built a rack on Monday. We were sanitizing some masks and doing some tests, and we realized that we could sanitize masks.
Clean Sleep uses UV light to sanitize mattresses and is trying to provide the same service for PPE. While they may not be up to the FDA standards for medical devices, Clean Sleep said they're servicing the mass of people who work in senior living facilities, student housing, and other non-medical uses of masks.
We had a third-party company do the testing on the efficacy of our machine. They've been able to prove that we can eradicate C. diff, staph, MRSA, VRE, all the critical pathogens and viruses found in the healthcare sector today. So, the CDC is allowing for us to make that claim based on eradicating all these other viruses and bacteria, because no one wants to get their hands on this stuff, right? And even begin to start culturing it and trying to test it, like, that's not happening. So if we can disrupt the RNA and the DNA of the virus, then that's enough proof to say that we can eradicate it. We have also filed for the emergency use application through the FDA. We were able to keep operations going, keep our employees, and, you know, expand the opportunity. Plus, we're also serving a good cause, right? This is something that, you know, is making an impact to our frontline workers.
Clean Sleep is charging about 50 cents per sanitized mask. They're also able to provide the same mask in a sanitized container back to the person who gave them the mask for decontamination.
I would imagine that it's easier and better to have the same mask back to you purely for that fit purpose.
I think the UV light doesn't damage the filter media for most of the systems we've looked at or the headbands. So we're waiting to see the FDA authorize that use, because when the FDA authorizes the use of a system, then they also make available the specific instructions.
The coronavirus pandemic will have a lasting impact on all aspects of life. But experts say it could lead to some positive changes in the medical supply chain. finding new ways to sanitize and reuse PPE may cut down on the amount of medical waste produced per hospital.
PPE is definitely a contributing factor to waste in the medical field. We use it because it keeps us safe and it keeps our patients safe and it creates a sterile environment, but it does create a lot of waste.
A mask doesn't need to be thrown away because it's been utilized for 6 hours, 8 hours, 12 hours, right? There's nothing wrong with this.
Coronavirus is changing the way we think about disease, and hospitals may decide that they need more respirators in their stockpiles. They may also decide to order more reusable respirators and PPE.
One of the options that we make available now to healthcare and discuss with them are the reusable respirators.
One thing that both the Ebola outbreaks recently and this COVID-19 pandemic have shown us is that we have to look at new strategies for both reusable PPE and alternatives to our standard PPE. I think we're a long way from having broad scale up of those approaches, but there are definitely companies working on this right now.
Some local governments have requested that the general public wear homemade face coverings when social distancing is not an option. Those masks could be sanitized by companies like Clean Sleep or washed at home by the wearer. Gowns and other types of PPE used in non-medical settings can be cleaned at home as they are not strictly regulated. With more people using PPE, the increased demand may also lead to design changes.
PPE is cumbersome. It's hard to work in. It creates an impersonality when you're interacting with a patient, and it fatigues people. It's hard to breathe in a PAPR. It's hard to breathe in a respirator, like an N95. It makes you more tired. It can overheat you or overexert you depending on the environment. So we have to be innovators in the way that we think about creating PPE, how we evaluate its efficacy, how quickly we can change. PPE is not a place where we innovate in a meaningful way.
If you're in this space and you recognize and capture the opportunities to help, right, create a sanitized environment, I think that we stand to continue to grow and to continue to serve.